Well, I guess it's time to start. 7 o'clock. Good evening. Welcome to the council meeting for April the 4th, 2016. I'm Mayor Ted Schaefer, and with me this evening are my council colleagues, Councillor Jack Arnold, Councillor Paul Albrecht, Councillor Rudy Storteboom, Councillor Gail Martin, and Councillor Nathan Pahal. And with us is our staff. We have Darren Light, Director of Corporate Services, Carolyn Machada, Manager, oh no, she's gone. Paula Cusack, Deputy Corporate Officer. Francis Chung, our CAO. Gerald Minchuk, our Director of Development Services and Economic Development. Rick Baumhoff, Director of Engineering, Parks and Environment. And Kim Hilton, Director of Recreation, Culture and Community Services. And Carolyn Machada is off doing some other things this evening. So Paula is the sub. Way to go. So adoption of the agenda. I need a motion that the April 4th, 2016 agenda be adopted as circulated. Councillor Storteboom, Councillor Albrecht. All those in favor? It's unanimous four. Minutes of the March 21st, 2016 meeting be adopted as circulated. Councillor Arnold, Councillor Martin. All those in favor? It's unanimous four. Tonight we have three community spotlights, and the first one is on the Fibromyalgia Wellspring Foundation. The sea of purple in the audience. So, who is Nigel? Is it yourself going to do the presentation today?
Yes.
Do you want to sit? And just make sure the mic is on.
Is the mic on?
Tap it and. Is it on? Perfect.
It's on. That's all right, I'll do it this way. Good evening, Mayor, Council, senior staff. We appreciate this opportunity to update you on our May events. You going to say something? No? Okay. I first like to thank you for your ongoing support with the grants that we get from the community. We appreciate them. If the slides don't work with me tonight, it's because we have a technical hitch. And we have brought some of the walkers that we're going to have on our trip to Banff. So we have a crazy crowd with us in purple here today. So, are you ready?
Let's try that again. Yes.
We're ready to go now? Okay, so basically the May events that we're trying to bring to your attention tonight is the two walks around Langley, which is the Free Us From Fibro walks, the flag racing. We had the first unveiling publicly of our flag outside here. We took a picture of all the crazy ladies holding the flag upside down. This is the flag that you guys are going to raise for us in May and have it up for a week. And then we're going to take it down, put it on the motorhome, and take it to Banff with us. Ooh. And they'll get them to raise it when we get there. So thank you for that. The celebration dinner on May the 12th, you're all invited to attend. This is our annual May 12th dinner. Where are you? I'm still on the first page. Okay. Anyway, thank you. So, May 7th, the annual walk around the city of Langley. We do a 1.2-kilometer walk around the city, and a 5-kilometer walk out to the airport and back along 56. And we'd like as many of you guys out to join us as you possibly would like to turn up. The May 9th, we will be out here and raising our flag for the first time ever. We appreciate that it's the city because that's where our thrift store and offices are. So we're looking forward to that.
Nigel?
Yes.
Where is your thrift store?
206 and Fraser Highway. 206. 31 Fraser Highway.
Oh,
so it's in the city.
Thank you.
Now, I don't think you've ever been, but you're more than welcome to come. Okay, May 12th is our 8th annual celebration dinner. This is held at Newlands, and this year we have 4 entertainers with us, so we're going to have a lot of fun. And anybody knows that the buffet at Newlands is really worth all the money to come. Okay. Tuesday, May the 24th, we leave on our walk to Banff. This is now 50 days away. We have spent over 2 years putting this walk together with highways and all of the people along the route. We would love to have as many of you out as possible just to take one more step on the walk. And that would be as far as you would like to walk out of the parking lot up to 208th, up to Abbotsford, whatever you feel you can accomplish. Okay? This is the... Where are you? We have a glitch, do we? Okay. The walk around Langley will start at... No, the 5 kilometer walk will start at 11 o'clock. The 1.2 will start at 1 o'clock, and both of them start from the thrift shop at 206 and Fraser Highway. Okay, May 7th, 5 kilometer walk at 11, 1.2 kilometer walk at 1. I'm working with the slides and I don't know what's going on up there. I'm reading these. Okay. The third annual walk on Saturday, May the 7th, we did the first ever walk for fibromyalgia in British Columbia around the city of Langley. And then somebody said they should do a 5 kilometer walk, which we did last year. And then some crazy lady said, I'd like to walk to Banff. And then all of a sudden we have now 17 people walking the whole distance and anywhere from 50 to 75 people walking in cities all along our route, because we're going from here to Hope to Carameas, up through the Okanagan to Sycamus, and then Highway 1 to Banff. Okay. I'm reading these.
No, you're not.
And I'm making a mess of it. Okay. Last year's event, we had Ted Schaefer and his wife out. And thank you very much. We hope you come back this year. And I expect to see Rudy there as well. Okay. Our fundraising goal for this walks around Langley this year is $6,000. And we need that to finish paying for the two motorhomes that we have got partly donated from Fraser Way RV in Abbotsford. The first annual flag raising, May the 9th, outside here with the flags at 10:30 at the City Hall. As I say, nobody's ever seen our flag before until tonight, so you get the first look at it. This flag was designed specifically to take us on our walk this year. We had it designed, we've got two of them, so we're going to put them on the motorhomes as we head out to Banff. So we invite everybody to come with us. The 8th annual dinner is at Newlands, as I mentioned. We hold a fibromyalgia celebration dinner every year. National Fibromyalgia Day is May 12th. And if I remember rightly, it is also... What is her name? Anyway, I'll get back to that. Okay, we invite everybody to come join us. It's $75 a ticket, and the meal is $39 worth of that, so you're getting a really good meal from the Newlands Buffet. We will have four different performers, a silent auction, a ticket draw, and we're really looking forward to having as many people out as possible this year. We have got pictures of last year's, which was an awful lot of fun. May 24th, this is the major event. I don't think anybody for fibromyalgia or any of the invisible illnesses has ever decided to walk from here to Banff. It's 1,100 kilometers. We're looking at 40 days and 40 nights. We're going to have a lot of fun. And for some of these crazy people, it's going to be absolutely life-changing because of what they're going to accomplish and what they're going to learn as we go along. We're hoping that we're going to have exposure all the way along. I have talked to every single council on the route, and every single one of them is going to stand out with us, and we're going to take pictures and have a photo opportunity with every single council on the road, and a lot of them have offered to come and walk part of the route with us. We were talking to... We went to Victoria to talk to the legislature, and we were standing in line at the back of the legislature at a barbecue, and The Premier noticed Cheryl, who we have spoken to several times. So she comes walking over. All of her, the RCMP officers were all wondering what was going on. She has said that if she is in her constituency office the day we walk by, because it's literally across the parking lot, that she'll come and walk through West Kelowna with us. So we're really hoping that we get that much exposure, because if she's walking with us, we're going to have TV exposure. And more exposure we can get for invisible illnesses, the better. And this is just a few of the diseases that we have expanded. What started off as a walk for fibromyalgia and chronic fatigue, we have a member of the board has been diagnosed with Lyme, so we added that. And then we added all this. I think there's something like 137 invisible illnesses that we're now walking for. So it's just not one thing, it's everybody that's got an invisible illness. High blood pressure, diabetes, migraines, you mention it, we're walking for it, okay? And this is the route that we're walking. And here's our feet walking along the road as we head to Banff. I'm just going to let that one go, catch up with that at the end. I love this slide. It's really, she's done a fantastic job with this slide. We're going to Banff, but we're going to stay for 2 days in Canmore, because we've got some things to do in Canmore and in Banff at the end of the route. We leave at 9 a.m. on May the 24th. So if you would like to come out, we have three or four bagpipers coming to walk us out from the foundation office to 208, and then we're on our own. But please come out and join us. We'd like to get as many people out as possible. How are we doing?
Good.
Okay, I'm done with that one. Okay, so if you would like to join us, we are taking donations. Any donation over $25 will get a tax receipt. So if you want donation sheets to walk with us, I'll get your donation sheets, and you can put as many names down as you like from family and friends. We have a GoFundMe, and that is gofundme.com/justonemorestep2016. And if anybody would like that, I will give it to them in an email. I can send it to the town, the city, and you can put it out for me. I'd appreciate that. Okay, so anybody got any questions? I try to keep it as quick and as short as possible. So we've got a whole bunch of crazy people here. So if you've got any questions, please ask.
I know staff have already put it on council calendars, and those council members that are available or around on that, because I know April, May, June is busy, so we're definitely try to make it. And if we don't see you, is there any questions? Rudy, or Councillor Storyville.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Nigel, and well, you call them crazy ladies. I think they're wonderful. And thank you very much for your presentation, and I even enjoyed the PowerPoint display. Have you been to Township Council with this as well? Okay. Well, you know what I was thinking is that you might like to contact all the municipal councils all along the way. I mean, if the Premier herself likes the idea of walking with you to draw attention, yeah, I'm sure that there's a few politicians on the way who'd like to walk with you as well.
We have touched base with every single city council, most of the MLAs, most of the MPs, all of the newspapers, and the only one that hasn't paid any attention to us yet is Global TV in Kelowna. They're the only ones. We've got native bands all along the route that are joining us, because I went to every single native band and asked permission to walk across their lands.
That's awesome.
Out of respect. So they're all on board. So the only ones that we're missing is Global TV.
Well, you've really done your homework. So congratulations to you.
We've spent 24 months working on this.
I know you've driven that route more than once as well to make sure everything's in place. So congratulations.
One more trip up on April the 16th, 17th, and 18th to make sure where the construction is and where we can't walk, because they're changing Manning Park, they're changing Highway 1, and we need to know where we can and can't walk, because I have to report back to Highways BC and give them the final route. And once we've done that, we can't move from it. We have to be there, because all of the RCMP traffic division need to know where we are on every day, so that if we need an escort from the RCMP, they know exactly where we start and finish that particular day.
Wow, what a tremendous effort for a very, very worthwhile cause.
So thank you very much. We appreciate your time. Thank you very much.
I'd be happy to walk you out of town.
Thank you.
So, seeing no further questions, thank you for coming, making the presentation, and hopefully we'll see you on May the 24th. Thank you for coming. Thank you to the group.
Wonderful lady.
So the next item we have on the agenda is a presentation by Superintendent Murray Power. And welcome, Murray, giving us an update on policing in Langley.
Good evening. Test, we on? Hear that?
Yep.
Good evening. There we go. I have three presentations to, they're not long, to bring forward tonight. First one is a quarterly update. And it will open with the year over year from 2014 to 2015. And as a preamble, there's nothing earth-shatteringly bad to report, which is always good. And
thank you for the presentation.
There
we'll
see
you next time.
So we'll just move on from here. And later on, I'm going to give you it's a one-slide snapshot of the five-year crime trend for just Langley City, and I'll explain a little bit later why I'm bringing that forward. So anyways, this is the year-over-year. As I've expressed in previous presentations, green is good. So as you can tell, not a bad year for year-ending 2015, and some of the basic categories there. Down in assaults, down in robberies, sex offenses up 46%, but again, that's a small number of six offenses year over year. And I continue to remind on certain crimes, sometimes larger numbers are good, the fact that they're being reported. Home invasions down 50%, but again, it's a small number, 8/4. Business break and enters, a bit of a pleasant surprise, because business break and enters has been a bit of a thorn in our side for the last year, and a significant effort by our members, hopefully starting to pay dividends, either that or the township businesses are being broken into. So residential break and enters, that's a nice reduction there, and auto theft up and down like yo-yo across the lower mainland. And it's been the crime for the last 18 months in Lower Mainland. So that's your year-ending numbers in a snapshot, and no really newsworthy significant events to rehash at this point in time. Now we'll just go to the first quarter of this year compared to the first quarter of last year. And again, reasonable numbers overall. And once again, down at the auto theft being the most significant concern, up 26% theft from autos. And again, those numbers tend to diminish pretty quickly if we make one or two strategic arrests of offenders out there. This is just a breakdown of the same thing, except in the real numbers over each and every month. So persons related to offenses for 3 months in the city of Langley, we've had 104, 601 property related offenses, and then they're just broken down by type, by month. One of the things that we always discuss is whether or not it's safe to walk the streets. Do we have random attacks, random assaults? And I'm pleased to continue to report that most of our assaults, most of our violent offenses are known to us. And the unknown ones down in this, right in the middle here, a lot of it's, you know, alcohol-related events, whether it be at bars, youth-related. No dramatic incidences. However, I temper that with a bit of a fresh investigation that has just taken place in the last week that's a little bit disturbing because I've seen the video from it. So we'll see where that one goes at the end of the day. But just to give you a heads up on potential disturbing news coming down the road here. And again, sex offenses, very small numbers for the 3-month period in the city. Just different graphs. As always, you want to keep sliding down to the right, and our numbers keep sliding down, and this is on violent crime. Graphs to the side, and this is just January's red, February's green, and purple is March of this year. So again, pretty low numbers all in all for the city. It's not my favorite slide. This incorporates both the city and the township, and as I've mentioned before, we're broken into 5 zones for policing. We've highlighted the city zone in green here, and that just gives you a bit of a sense as to the different zones in the township and how they relate to some of the numbers. We have a 55% increase in assaults here, but again, that's six specific incidents change year over year. This one kind of caught my attention. I'll tell you why. This red line that you see running across the top here, that's on the bottom. It says 5-year average, and that's just the rolling average that every 5 years, what is the number? And we try to stay below that, as any good police agency would. And I was quite pleased. The blue is the township and the city together, and the green is just the city offenses. But again, even putting us together, trending down below the 5-year average quite significantly, which is a nice thing in spite of a disappointing January. But again, the numbers are fairly small, all things considered. And this breaks down, let me back up, that's all persons offenses. Then go down to assaults, and that's a significant drop under the 5-year average, so much so that I called our analysts up to make sure the numbers were correct. It's, again, very encouraging to see that. So we'll enjoy it while we can. Robberies, again, it's a nice sign, and robberies are very very determinant about a small number of individuals that may be going through a tough time, and it's the type of crime that seems to build upon itself. If you do one, then you tend to and get away with it, then you think you can get away with it multiple times. So robberies go in spits and starts, and obviously we're on a positive trend at this point in time. Another graph on property offenses, pretty Melba toast, a lot of flat lines here. Again, a spike in auto theft in February, as you can see here. And theft from auto, that's a bit of a concerning trend going upwards, but as we found in years past, if we get the right people, those numbers diminish quite quickly. But fairly flat in an overall situation. Possibly the worst slide that you'll see tonight, which is just everything jammed into one slide. So some negatives here, a few increases here, but again, these are for the we'll back up. That's this column here, 2015 year to date, 2016. That's just for the city. So it's a bit of a rehash of what we've seen earlier on. Again, theft from auto being the big issue down here. And I'll have a comment on shoplifting in another slide here. All property offenses, again, the growth in the township, you'll see a lot more theft from autos, more vehicles, potential residential break and enters, fairly flat in the city down here. Business break and enters, good trend for the city in the green, going right down to 11 for 2 months in a row. And again, starting to trend below the 5-year average, it's a good time to be here. And residential, always one of the crimes that personally I watch very closely. Citywide, 11, 4, and 6, that's a pretty good start to the year for residential break-and-enters. We really must protect people's residences accordingly. And auto theft, you can see, it doesn't take much. You got one bad month, 117 stolen vehicles in the Langleys in February alone. And we've seen that over the last 18 months. We will get a month or two where we'll get a spike. And you'll see that trend run across the entire Lower Mainland. And they're basically used as transportation vehicles from one, either for just commuting or for crime purposes, going from one location to another. Theft from auto, this is a significant increase, again, in relation to the Langleys together and then the city down here. Would suggest that we have more of a problem up in the township area than compared to the city for theft from auto. However, if we remember from the earlier slides, theft from auto is on the increase in the city itself as well. So we're likely looking at the same offenders. This is a proactive work. And again, as you can see, zone 3 is the city. And street checks in the city significantly higher than any other jurisdiction out there. And we break them down by watch. As you can tell, D-Watch does very well at our detachment, very proactive on the streets at nighttime. And this is just a different graph to show the same numbers, January, February, March, for the city street checks. And that's just getting out of our cars, being on foot, checking the people that are out and about, usually after hours while everybody's sleeping, so we know who's wandering the streets. Any questions on that before I load up the next one here?
Questions? Councillor Pahal.
Thanks. You mentioned something about disturbing news. Did you elaborate on that, or did I miss that?
No, I didn't.
Okay.
You have to wait, unfortunately,
until
things develop. So.
Further questions of?
Not this time.
Not this time.
Oh, the teaser, Rudy. So what I did is I'm going to zoom this in so we can watch this a little bit better, and I'll explain what all the circles and squares are about. When I came here in mid-2013, and I've had conversations with most of council and your worship, and I've been staunchly held the position that the perception of crime in the city was always misrepresented. And I get asked quite a bit, what I base that on, and sort of watch the numbers. I thought I'd put together had our analysts put together a 5-year trend for some of the main crime types in the city alone. And some of the numbers were better than even I had expected. So what I'll do is I'll zoom this in. I'll just take you a little section by section here. Squeezing my screen here. Anyway, so what you want to look at here, what I've done is if you have a yellow on the right, that's a decrease from the red square box on the left, okay? And each year at the top, 2011, 2012, and then the percentage change from 11 to 12. Like, and if it's got a highlighted color, it's a plus. And then, of course, no highlights is a negative. 2013, and that change will be from year to year, not running on a combined method. So anyways, the murders and attempted murders, those numbers are all significantly low, so we won't worry too much about that. But just to give you an example, robberies here, 2011, in the city alone, you had 46, went even higher in 2012, an 8% increase. Then we started to make some headway down to 41, then we go down to 34, and now we're down to 41. And even that 41 is a 17% increase from 2014. Yet it's still lower than 5 years ago in 2011. Okay, let's go over to the violent crime here, or the assault piece. 280 assaults, okay, steady decline, as you can see, down 6%. Then the next year went down another 21%. Pretty flat. And then even though we're up 4%, we're still down, 57 incidences 5 years later on a year-over-year basis. So again, trending in the right direction over a long period of time. This one's pretty significant, assault causing bodily harm from the 70s, the 60s, the 70s again, and then we dropped down last year to 49. So again, from the safety perspective, trending in the right direction, and that's on the violent crime. We'll move over to the property crime series here. And the first number is overall break and enters, and then it's broken down. The 400 equals 259 plus 93 plus 48, just so you know. So in 2011, we're looking at 400. It goes up to 479 in 2012, so you know, an increase of 16%. Then we start dropping down 2013. Then we go down another 100 in 2014, 2015. We still have a 10% increase, yet we're still down quite a bit over the last five-year period. So again, business break and enters, five-year growth in business, yet our overall business break and enters goes down. Residential break and enters, very pleasing numbers to see that go down. But when I make the circle, we had a bit of a hiccup before we started coming back down. This, unfortunately, this, I believe this should be 161. The math just doesn't add up otherwise. But again, there we go with the auto theft. And the auto theft, as you can see, now we have a reversal. This is where the numbers have gone up. Even though we're down 31% 2014 to 2015 in auto theft, look where we were, 262, 197, 239, 182. That's a lot of vehicles that are stolen over a year. And then they're broken down into cars, trucks, and others in the lines below that. So an ongoing problem, probably the number one crime in the Lower Mainland has to be auto theft. It's from a property crime perspective. A couple jurisdictions, North Vancouver, UBC, really suffer from bicycle thefts. And although it sounds like, oh, bicycle thefts, those that ride bicycles know that they cost thousands of dollars now, and they're a really significant issue over there. But Surrey, Langley, Maple Ridge, Coquitlam, we collectively work hard to identify auto thieves moving forward. But again, for 2015, that's a pretty nice set of numbers on a downward trend compared to 2014. Now here, a little footnote for you here. This is a shoplifting. So you see, you know, shoplifting is up 21%, but shoplifting is a unique crime that I try to keep out of our other total stats because police have very little control over shoplifting. We prosecute what's brought to us, but we're at the mercy of loss prevention officers doing their job. So it's not something that we can go out and do much work on to prevent crime. And remember, shoplifting that's reported to us is pretty much a solved crime. Most shoplifting goes unreported. So this is what's been identified. So you can imagine the real theft is going to be in the thousands of individual incidences. So it's a bit of a unique crime where you look at an increase and you think, oh my goodness, well, actually that's a positive sign because it means there's more enforcement, there's more positive things going on. And the second piece to the increase is we get a lot of files now that we never received years before, and it pertains to the quality of video that retailers have, realtors, and or retailers, not realtors, pardon me. And we're getting some great quality stills of suspects that they know just stole something from the liquor store or from Walmart or whatever store it might be. And we're sharing that information within the detachment. We're identifying quite a number of these individuals for the purpose of charging them with the theft. So that's also going to increase our shoplifting numbers. So increased shoplifting numbers, that's one of those anomalies that I would say is a good thing. And the second one down here, the last section, is the drug series. Again, I've spoken to council a couple times before, and increased drug enforcement, that's a good sign. That means our troops are getting out in the street and they're making a difference, whether it be the dedicated drug unit or whether it be the uniformed members stopping cars. And believe it or not, most of our drug seizures by numbers come from our traffic unit because they stop the most cars. They make these observations, they see the hinky behavior, they smell, they're very astute, and so that's where a lot of our numbers do come from. So you have to understand stats, and there's two anomalies that you want to see increases on as we go forward. So I threw this together, didn't throw it together, we put this together for the purpose of trying to give a sense of comfort to the community that, you know, Langley City is it's trending in the right direction. The people are good, the businesses are good. I think it's something that you should be proud of, and it's something that you shouldn't shy away from sharing the news if you want to. So here's the hard numbers that you can assess at your desire. And one more thing, just on a slightly lighter note, those from the chamber dinner, remember Staff Sergeant Carr spoke of a project that we had going on with regards to theft of Lego. And I can't give you all the details yet because it's not completed in the court process yet. However, this pertained to, interestingly enough, this pertained to a shoplifting ring that was very, very busy, not only in the Langleys but in the Lower Mainland. So I asked the guys just to gather the exhibits that they had seized, and so they did. Now, it doesn't look like much, but you start counting across here. That's six bins. That's double stacked, and they go back. So that's 12, 24, 36 plus, it looks like about 48 bins worth of Lego and high-end collectible toys. Now, if you don't have kids or grandkids, you might not appreciate the value of Lego. And it is quite a marketplace. And the sale of that on Craigslist is quite significant. And next time you're in the mall, go in and find out how much Lego costs. And this runs into, I believe, $40,000 or $50,000 worth of retail goods here. That were seized, and this is just from one group that was coordinated, and they were running from, coordinatedly running from store to store to store. We work with a lot of the stores. The suspects were identified and were banned from certain stores. Some stores took different methods, from taking the Lego off the shelves, and you would have to ask for it to buy it. And that's kind of the way forward. Is we want to share some of our results with the retail business community so that some best practices can be looked at to deter groups like this. And this little ET character, I think he was worth about $1,200 on his own, and he's a little bit bigger than he looks like, and ET would be the one in the middle there, not these other characters. But so that's the crew that was responsible for putting this all together. So we're optimistic that the entire case will come to a quick conclusion here. The charge is laid. The suspect is still in jail, which is a positive thing. And there's other factors that we're still waiting for the court process to go through. So that's what I have for you tonight, Your Worship. Any questions on anything?
Well, I know the one Lego. We picked one up at Christmas time. It was for the one box. Just one. It's $250. And starts to add up as you go into multiple Lego boxes.
Apparently I was a millionaire as a kid and didn't know it.
Star Wars right now, there's a Star Wars action figure worth $9,000 from the late 70s. So one action figure, $9,000.
Yes, it's...
So the collectibles and the games like Lego, there's quite a market for it.
Yeah, there was what you didn't see in the pictures in some of those boxes, because I saw them up close. Sports collectibles, there was some very valuable sports collectibles were also recovered during this investigation.
So, further questions? Councillor Pakal.
Thank you, Your Worship. So for the five-year trends, you are wanting people to know about that? Like that stat there is public information and shareable?
I've been trying to sell this since I got here.
Okay, so keep that on the computer and I'll grab it then.
Fair enough.
Okay.
Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Superintendent. I really appreciate your special effort in pulling this together for us and interpreting what all the numbers and the stats mean, because just at face value, it's pretty hard to figure out for yourself. But I am curious to know if you have any driving stats for us, driving under the influence, distracted driving, anything like that. If not, maybe next time?
Definitely can get those for you, because we have those collected on a regular basis, and it's just not something that I've ever incorporated, but I think it's a very valuable piece. And
well, just a footnote, if you don't mind, I'm curious to know what kind of numbers we're coming up with, because I think this is Distracted Driving Month, and there's a program on right now that's especially geared to distracted drivers and getting them off the cell phone when they're driving. So
that's correct, Councillor. You're right on with that.
More awareness of that would certainly be worthwhile.
Yep. And when we do our community meetings, those that know me know that that's not my forte, it's not my background, and the traffic questions always come up, and I always have to defer those, but it is one of the top concerns of the community is traffic enforcement. So, yeah, we'll definitely start including those. That's
well, I'd appreciate the special effort. Thank you very much.
No problem.
And thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Further questions? You're off the hook.
It's a beautiful thing. Thank you for your time.
Thank you for coming and sharing the info with us. And it's nice to see the city's going in the right direction.
Yes.
And say, please, thank you to, was it D-Shift? The one that is doing all the road checks in the evening?
Oh, yeah, that's right, D-Watch, yes.
D-Watch.
I will pass that on. I have them all on Wednesdays.
Let's see if they can increase those a little bit.
Okay, we'll work on that.
Yeah. If they increase it, I'll buy them a lunch.
Okay.
Thank you. Thank you for the presentation. So the next item we have is Chief Rory Thompson giving us an update on the fire department.
Thank you very much, Your Worship. Here's our quarterly update for the City Fire Rescue Service. And I'm going to do part of the presentation and talk about some aspects about the medical calls, and Kelly's going to talk about some of the fires that we've had recently. So we've had a bit of a shift in some of our call stats, and the most notable one is an increase in our MESA, or medical calls. So we've gone from about 78% of our calls, and it's starting to edge up into the 80s now. A large increase that we're experiencing is as a result of overdoses, and I'm just going to talk about that in a couple minutes. The rest of the statistics are pretty static, so that's good. So again, about 81% of our calls are MESA in origin, followed by alarms and public service calls. Unfortunately, the number of fires that we have is one of the least events that we attend. So drug overdoses, we've had quite a spike, and the spike appears to be sustaining certainly throughout the first quarter. Last year we attended, I believe, 80 overdoses altogether throughout the year. And in the first 3 months, we've gone to 62 overdoses. So that projected into the future, we're looking at going from 80 up to around 240, 260 overdoses. And a lot of the problem seems to be because of the mix of the street drugs that are now showing up, whereas before, traditional overdoses that we would see would be strictly heroin or some other street drugs, but especially now we're noticing that some of the heroin is coming laced with fentanyl. So when a user would take a usual dose perhaps of 1 point of heroin, when they take 1 point of heroin that's also laced with fentanyl, then that's throwing them into an overdose situation. Some of the departments in the Lower Mainland have opted to start looking at increasing their scope of practice to have naloxone. And naloxone perhaps is known through some of its other brand names. For example, Narcan is a brand name of naloxone. And what they are, they block the opiate receptors in the brain. So the introduction of Narcan or naloxone stops the ability of opiate-based street drugs from reacting. And it usually has a shelf life, you know, between, you know, 30 minutes or so. And then it starts to taper off, 30 minutes to 90 minutes, depending on how much is introduced. So some departments are looking at introducing that. And one of the main reasons is because of the length of time it takes for the British Columbia ambulance to show up in support of the first responders. In some communities, Maple Ridge, for example, they seem to have a significant delay in ambulance attending some of these calls. We're pretty fortunate here in analyzing the calls that we had in January, and I think we had 32 calls in January. The ambulance typically in Langley is showing up an average of about 3 minutes after we do. So that's very good. If a department opts to look at using naloxone, of course they have to have trained in it, but they have to show up, they have to assess the situation, they have to form the opinion that perhaps it might be in the patient's best interest to administer it, and then they have to phone up a doctor on call, relay all the information, the doctor has to make a decision, and give the go-ahead for the crews to administer it. And that takes a few minutes. And so what we're finding is in that length of time that it would take us to do the assessment, contact the doctor, and decide to proceed with the administration of naloxone, usually the ambulance is already there. So we're not finding ourselves in the same situation that perhaps Surrey, Vancouver, Maple Ridge is. Interestingly enough, the federal government has recently deregulated naloxone. It's now available over the counter. And recently we had our first use of naloxone by a bystander, which we believe was another street drug user who was with their buddy. Their buddy went down from an overdose, and so the other person administered it. So at this point, we're going to continue to monitor the situation, see whether or not there's any reason for us to shift our scope of practice to include the use of naloxone, but at this point in time, we don't think that that's the right step for us to take. And right now, even though we've had a small dip in February, it seems to be a little bit cyclical, but we're anticipating that the same level of response to overdoses is going to be there, at least for the foreseeable future. Are there any questions on our overdose situation?
Councillor Arnold.
Yeah, you said that you went through how long it takes for you guys to do it. You phone the doctor and so on and so on. And you said that in that amount of time, the ambulance is usually there?
That's correct, yes.
But then when the ambulance gets there, what do they have to do? Do they just make the decision themselves?
Their license allows them to go ahead and do the assessment and make the decision and introduce naloxone without consulting a physician.
Okay, so they don't have to go through all the same procedure and everything. That's okay.
Yep.
Thank you.
Counselor. And interesting enough, when I talked to Surrey, even though they've introduced the protocol to their first responders, they found that over a three-month period that they've only used it twice. And I think that's over several hundred responses. So the likelihood of us being in a situation, and when I examined all the records from January through to the end of the March, there really wasn't an opportunity reading the reports where we likely would have used naloxone.
Councillor Albrecht.
Yeah, thank you for your report, and thank you for the update and the understanding that you're going to be continuing to monitor this situation. But I have to assume that you would be looking at the use or the treatment versus liability issue as part of that review or part of that analysis. So, but I don't want to just assume something. I should be saying that we should be making sure that we're not putting ourselves at any kind of a liability by not either being trained properly or administering properly or not being able to do it correctly. So,
right. It would be an increase to our scope of practice, which is licensed. So we would be going through the appropriate training. There would be medical oversight that would be involved, as is with all of our treatments that we administer as first responders.
Councillor Pahal.
Thank you very much. You noted that we went from about 78% of your calls were medical in nature. What year was that?
That was 2015.
Okay. Has there been a slow upward trend, or was there a year where you noticed like a large shift to the medical calls?
The medical calls have always been a large proportion of the type of calls that we go to. So there really hasn't been a significant shift. Those have always been there. It's just been over the past 4 months or so where we've really seen a spike, especially with the overdose calls, which is pushing us up from the 78% responses being medical up into the 80s.
So the big change is the overdoses, and that's something new, the sharp increase that we see right here.
Yes.
Yeah.
Overall, we're increasing at a rate of about 10% per year overall for all the calls.
In the last 5 years, it was 17%
per year.
Overall.
Okay, so in the last 5 years, overall, we've had about a 17% increase in the total volume of calls we've gone to. So our number of calls does climb each year. So speaking of calls, one thing that was kind of interesting, we thought we were pretty busy, and so we decided to have just a quick little scan to see how what we do compares to some of the other busiest engines in other lower mainland departments. So the busiest engine in the lower mainland is Surrey's Engine 2, and in 2014, and we don't have more recent records just offhand, Surrey's Engine 2 responded to 2,619 calls, and we ended up being down at number 4. So our Engine 1 is a pretty busy engine when you compare it to other departments, and is certainly just as busy as Vancouver's Engine 2. And Engine 2, of course, runs out of Station 2, which is at the corner of Main and Cordova, I believe. So it's in the downtown east side. So they've got a pretty busy engine there. We're just as busy. Given the number of increase in medical calls that we had recently, and in the general increase that we get from year to year, if these trends continue, we're going to be pushing the number of responses for Engine 1 up into the 2700s for 2016. So pretty busy all in all. And in terms of fire loss, we've had a number of significant fires, which Deputy Chief Gilday is going to go over. So again, any particular fire, singular fire, can push the statistics up. We had one injury, and that was due to a smoke inhalation. And that person was taken for monitoring up at Langley Memorial. But $743,000 is the reportable loss for the first quarter. And I'll turn it over to the Deputy Chief.
Your Worship, we've had five significant fires at multi-residential complexes here in the last couple of months, and 71% of all our fires are multi-residential, so it's quite a risk to the community. So the five mentioned, there's some significant loss there, 260,000 one, just under 100,000 for a couple of the others, and about 300,000 for that. But what's more a problem for us is that there's more people displaced each time. So it might be just one apartment building, but there might be six affected or 10 suites affected, and you have 10 or 20 people put out for a period of a week or a month or whatever. So, but what's alarming now is that three of these fires were what we believe due to either drug-related activity or one, the most significant one, was the explosion where the individual was, we believe, was making a hash oil product using a butane-type system, who blew the apartment apart inside and with a one-year-old child in the building. So it was a big problem for us. But it affects the others in the residential areas as well. You know, three of these, they don't have insurance, which is no big deal for them, but it affects everybody else's insurance and damage to the building and cost to the residents that own those properties. So we try and get there and do as much as we can, but we're seeing a bit of a trend trying to come up with problems in the residential ones, especially due to drug activity or whatever. So we're keeping an eye on that. There's not a lot we can do on that one, but except keep an eye on it and keep responding. So we do see that, and we're going to see where that trend goes over the next little bit as well, and increase some education, some inspections, which our fire prevention office is doing for those residential areas. So.
Councillor Albrecht.
What's that? Yep. And we got a video on the last fire. A lot of things came into play on this fire, having it so close to the fire hall, but this fire actually spread quite quickly and was quite hot, but there was nothing in the suite, which doesn't make any sense. There was no reason for a fire to happen in that suite except a couple people living there. No furniture, nothing. And so because of that, we were able to extinguish it quite quickly, but it still affected six suites in there where six people were displaced, and I believe that are still out at that end of the building. So we'll show you the video on this one.
You got a question first. Councillor Albrecht.
Yeah, thanks, Kelly, for your report. I'm kind of curious on something like this. A lot of these apartments are obviously rentals. Do we get, in a proactive manner, let's say, a notification to the landlords to let them know what your findings are of the fires and try to get some of the, say, the neighboring complexes advised of that kind of activity or whatever the cause of the fires to get that, you know, advertised out there to be proactive?
Yeah, we do actually. We do with the property owner. A lot of these are owned properties, Your Worship, but they rent them out. So we deal with the property owners. And then, of course, you know, it's really apparent the tenants or the people that live there in the tenancy groups or the strata groups are well aware of it, and they're in contact with us trying to deal with the issue as well. But once somebody gets in and rents a place, it's very difficult to get them out. And what they do in there, unless we know about it and we can take action on it, if it's something we can act on, it's very difficult. But we are doing a proactive thing. We are doing education, especially in some of the ones that have had some problems, really dealing with the strata group to try and clean it up a bit, I guess. So.
Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. And thank you for your presentation. Just a quick question with regard to this slide in particular. I can see from previous slides that the number of fire instances has gone up significantly, and I can't help but be curious if there is any kind of a pattern as to the source of these fires. Do you know the sources of these particular five fires that we've got here, or are they still under investigation?
We know the source. Three of them we suspect were because of either a lifestyle activity, a lot of drug paraphernalia. One was manufacturing a drug-type material. And the other one was, again, with a lot of drug paraphernalia and maybe lifestyle habits. So
these could be patterns that we will be seeing duplicated in the months to come. Thank you for that information. Yeah. Thank you, Mr. Mayor.
One more thing, Councillor. Your Worship, we're doing a bit of an active campaign to try and make the homeowners aware of how little it costs for content insurance for rentals. It's hard enough going there and seeing everything they have gone, but then they have no insurance, and for a few dollars they could have. So we're trying to do a bit of a promotional thing, not trying to sell insurance, but just to have the homeowners aware that, you know what, if they just make that small purchase, it can ease them at the end of the day when something like that happens. So, yeah.
Excellent. Councillor Arnold.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. You mentioned that you try and get together and meet with strata councils and so on on those properties, but on the rental properties, they wouldn't have a strata council.
On the buildings that are just all rental, then it's the building owner that we deal with. And they deal with the building owner and the fire safety plan to try and get the message out. And on those types of properties, there's not a lot of participation. We try and engage them, and we try and do it through our inspection process. But we have very limited powers when it comes to just a rental property with somebody in there. The building owner is our primary source of contact, and it's very difficult to get them to do much with. some of their tenants.
Okay, but you do still go through the same process, just with the owner instead of the council?
Yes.
All
right.
Further questions?
This was the apartment where there was nothing in the suite. And you can see the intensity of the fire, which doesn't make any sense for nothing in the suite. And that, but when we actually got to it and got a hose on it, it was easy to extinguish it because there was no fire load in there. And that, so we were lucky on this one, retrieving one individual off the back balcony who was stranded on the balcony while trying to put the fire out in the front. And we found this over the last couple of years. This was probably, even though it seemed simple, our most challenging fire because of the dynamics of what took place there. So, but it was a good effort put in by the department and all the members of the department to try and get it out and get things under control right away. The potential to lose the entire building with something like this is huge. And once it gets up into the rafters and that, a building like this is usually gone. So we were pretty lucky on this one.
So how many suites are affected by this fire then?
Six.
Six. And at what point is the building uninhabitable? Like, was there power cut off?
Well, what we try and do is...
water damaged elsewhere?
Yeah, we try and minimize the water damage. We cut the power off right away, and then we take a look at it and see if we can isolate some of the suites. We have the building owner bring an electrical contractor in to see if we can isolate the affected suites, and then turn the gas on and the power on and back on to the unaffected suites. And then they have to bring a restoration company in who will do some air monitoring for them and see if it is inhabitable. And if it is, they'll try and let those people go back in, keeping the people out of the affected suites. We try and get people back in as soon as possible without compromising their health. Yeah, it is, and we wondered why it went so fast and in the investigation, and it burnt through the floor on that one. And but in the investigation, there was nothing in the suite. We're still concluding it, but it doesn't look, there's no reason for it. So we've taken some samples, and we're just still proceeding with the investigation on it.
And that video was courtesy of Eric Vogel.
Yeah.
If you look over to the left-hand side, up in this area here, you can see a person on their balcony. So that was a person that we actually had to go in and rescue with a ground ladder. They tried to make escape through the main corridor of the building, but it was fully charged with smoke. So this fire started and it spread so quickly that that person was not able to effect escape on their own.
And despite efforts of fire prevention and the crews who go and do the inspections, because we get so many alarm calls because of some of the activity in some of the buildings, many of the tenants don't evacuate. Yeah. And despite how often we tell them they must, they don't. And so which leads to this, you know, you're changing from doing a fire attack to a rescue. And with the staffing that we have, you've got to be careful on which one you choose first and where it's going to go. So it's sometimes pretty tough.
So despite the fact that even though the fire was knocked down a bit on the outside, if you notice over in the left-hand side up in here, there's still fire burning. So you still have to drag hoses up inside the building and go after the fire. So this sort of approach to apply water from the outside just sets the clock back a few minutes for us and gives us time. If we initially had gone right inside the building, by the time we had gotten those hoses ready to go, and to enter down the corridor towards the fire. Up on the outside of the building would have spread up into the third floor and up into the attic and roof space of the building.
Wow, very dramatic.
Further questions of Rory or Kelly?
Okay, just a quick recap on some of the training that we've done in the first quarter. We're carrying on with our emergency scene management review. So that's the strategies and tactics of the incident commander, making sure that they're keeping honed in their skills. So we're running them all through just refresher courses. This last weekend we did live fire training with our paid on-call firefighters. up at the Township Fire Training Center. We had specific training from an outside instructor in multi-story residential fires, so that was kind of timely. We concluded that training sort of before we seemed to run into all these apartment fires. And we're carrying on training with our four new paid on-call firefighters. Thank you.
Good. Seeing there's no questions, thank you for the presentation, gentlemen. So the next item we have is under the mayor's report. The next regular council meeting is April 25th. The next one after that is May the 9th. And under Metro Vancouver, Councillor Storderboom, do you have anything to report?
Well, yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor. The Board of Directors met on this past Friday when Honorable Peter Fassbender, Minister for Community, Sport and Cultural Development, as well as Minister responsible for TransLink, attended the Metro Vancouver Board of Directors meeting to invite a consultation process to begin about the new technology and the emerging shared economy initiated in the marketplace by the likes of Uber and Airbnb. This business model seems to be gaining significant momentum, so possible legislation around regulations, insurance, and licensing are being considered to provide a wider variety of service options while protecting the public. Metro Vancouver is expected to respond with proposals for possible changes to the Transportation Act. There was also some conversation around the need to replace the George Massey Tunnel. Affected municipalities were establishing their positions, and going forward, much of the conversation can be expected to include environmental and efficiency concerns. I know that all of council received packages from the municipality of Delta, and they're making themselves known with this regard. The city of Richmond is taking a different view. In the end, the board approved sending a letter to the federal minister of the environment and climate change requesting that the minister order a federal environmental assessment of the George Massey Tunnel replacement project. Also, directors received a report from the Climate Action Committee about the BC leadership plan and how it will be critical for Metro Vancouver to reach its greenhouse gas reduction targets and prepare municipalities facing the impacts of climate change. Staff is preparing a report for consideration at Wednesday's Climate Action Committee meeting, and information will be forthcoming. In response to a recent report, the board is pursuing municipal interests by petitioning the federal government to include local government in the Department of Aboriginal Affairs and Northern Development Canada's review of land claims policies and processes when consulting First Nations groups. The board endorsed a report prepared at the request of the Minister of State for Emergency Preparedness about possible revisions to the Emergency Program Act. The Sewer and Drainage Board awarded a contract for Phase 2 design, build, finance, procurement, consulting services for the Lionsgate Secondary Waste Treatment Plant project. And there will be a Council of Councils meeting scheduled for Saturday, April 23rd in Port Coquitlam. And I would encourage all of my council colleagues to attend. And thank you, Mr. Mayor. That is my report.
Thank you. The next item we have is library happenings. Councillor Martin.
Thank you. City of Langley Library Happenings for Monday, April the 4th. Last week, the City of Langley Library was excited to launch the automated materials return in the new Tim's Community Center lobby. The outdoor automated return will be launched when construction is in the surrounding areas complete. So this new automated return that we have, the staff spent time showing customers how the automated return works and answering questions for the public. And I think all of council should go down and have a look at the machine if they haven't already. The machine, known in various circles as the octopus or the sorter, uses RFID technology to sort materials by type and funnel them via conveyor belt to one of the five bins in the sorter room. Library staff checks returned audiovisual materials for contents, but otherwise all materials are checked by the sorter. This eliminates many of the repetitive motions and corresponding potential for musculoskeletal injuries. I'm sure that's something to do with the muscles that come with manually checking in hundreds of items a day. Library staff will also have more time to provide friendly service and valuable programs to the public and continue to make the library a welcoming and exciting hub. So it's very exciting that we have this new sorter in the library, and do have a look at it because it really works great.
Up to date technology.
Yes, that's for sure. Yeah, state of the art stuff. And I'll continue with tourism.
Tourism. Okay. Councillor Martin, tourism.
Thank you. As reported last month, the Marketing Committee was seeking an agency to design and deliver a creative destination marketing campaign that would target the leisure traveler. The campaign will be at least a year long and will include video and imagery content as well as social media and paid advertising. The concept is aimed to increase the appeal of Langley to the leisure market. Two agencies were selected and will be working together with the team at Tourism Langley. We're very excited about the concept that was introduced. It's about taking time to pause and enjoy. Tourism Langley will be offering a sneak peek at the concept at their AGM. And being a member of the marketing committee, we spent 5 hours one day interviewing these, and I think it's going to be a really exciting campaign. And speaking of Tourism Langley AGM, it is Thursday, April the 7th, and they want to thank Mayor Schaefer and those council members who will be attending in support of tourism in the City of Langley and the organization in general. In addition to preparing for the AGM this past month, Tourism Langley has also been in the planning stages for a tourism showcase of Langley businesses, products, and services. It is called Langley Lineup. This is a new opportunity hosted by Tourism Langley for local businesses to meet one-on-one with the frontline and hospitality staff from the Lower Mainland in preparation for the 2016 visitor season. The more frontline staff can learn about our community, the more we can offer to our visitors. The event will be held on May the 26th. This showcase opportunity will also be unveiled at the AGM this week, and staff will be working to ensure as many businesses as possible participate in this event. The first meeting of the new Board of Directors will be on April the 19th. They're looking forward to this meeting as the organization is currently going through a governance review. An outside firm will be delivering a best practices and board governance workshop, which has been identified by the board as being important this year. Tourism Langley has been in operation for 8 years now, and a review is going to help guide and strengthen the organization during this important year of the hotel tax renewal. Thank you.
Thank you, Councillor Martin. Any questions? Seeing none. Oh. All right. Engineering update. Mr. Baumhoff.
All right. Thank you very much. And so as an update, the rain barrel sale program has been set for May 8th. It will be at the Willowbrook Shopping Center from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. on May 8th. The sale price is $55 per rain barrel. Regular retail price is, including taxes, around $90, so it's about a $35 savings. The $55 includes taxes. So people can go online to enviroworld.ca /Langley, and they can pre-order there. It's recommended that people do pre-order so that they can bring enough barrels to the event. But they can, if they don't pre-order, that doesn't necessarily mean they don't get them. They can go to the event and still, but it'll be a limited quantity available. We've issued notice of construction. We've actually started salt lane today. We're replacing the water line, being replaced with a 150 millimeter PVC main. It's an old 25 millimeter copper water line right now. We're adding an additional fire hydrant about mid lane. This improvement will improve water quality, pressure, and fire protection reliability in that area. And the drive aisle and parking in the lane will be paved in late April, replacing the brick surface with asphalt, and the sidewalks will remain brick. So there'd be a curb line along the edge with the driving lane and the parking, and it'll be brick on the sidewalks. The salt lane entrance signs are also being replaced. This is just a shot of them removing the salt lane signs in preparation for the water line project. Also on 53rd Avenue, the traffic calming has been implemented, and this is just a shot of one of the speed humps. So it includes two speed humps and a raised crosswalk at 201A, as well as curb bump outs. And Linwood Park Community Garden has been expanded. We've added 10 new gardens, and as well as 6 new raised beds for physically disabled or people that have difficulty bending down so they can access the raised beds. So that's an improvement at the garden. And also you can see there the shed has also been installed in preparation for this coming season. And thank you very much.
Thank you. Questions? Councillor Martin, Councillor Pajon.
Thank you. Yeah, the 53rd traffic calming. First of all, I think the crew that worked there did an excellent job. At times, the traffic was quite tied up, especially when they were doing the crosswalk and the curb bulges. But I found them very accommodating and very friendly. So, I thought they did a great job. And it was fairly quick that they did the job in, too. My initial thoughts on the 53rd speed bumps, I didn't think they were high enough. But I do believe it's slowing traffic down. I guess when I thought of a speed bump, I didn't think it would sort of be that flowing thing, but it does slow the traffic down. And what I do is I try and, the speed sign is still up on the post there, so I try and watch to see what the cars are doing. And you're not seeing 40 and 50 and 60 kilometers an hour anymore with the speed bumps. But one concern that I had prior to us doing this, Mr. Baumhoff, was the sight lines going north on 201A at 53rd and traffic coming from the west, from the school towards 201A, that it was very difficult to see any cars coming. And I know that you said you were going to move the traffic back and the curb bulges would help. I can't say that has helped, the curb bulges. What I see are pickup trucks parked right up to the curb bulge and other cars, and you cannot see cars coming. So I don't know whether how we can move the traffic back a little bit more so you're more aware of the cars that are coming along 53rd. Now, it may not be as big of a problem now because they're obviously driving slower than what they were before. Mm. But that's still a concern of mine, certainly, is the sight lines from 201 heading north, 201A and 53rd heading north, traffic coming from the west. So
okay.
Whether it's a big deal or not, but I thought it would be better once the curb bulges and that were in. But when you have a big pickup truck parked right at the curb bulge, you can't see a little car coming up 53rd Avenue. So just a thought.
Yeah. And we can monitor that, give it a little bit of time, and if it continues to be an issue, we can address it further.
Okay, but otherwise, they did a beautiful job in there. It's great. Thank you.
Great.
Councillor Pajon, then Albrecht, then Arnold.
Thank you very much. For the salt lane replacement, just two questions for you. The salt lane sign, is that being replaced with a new sign, or are you putting the existing one back?
Yes, it's being replaced with a new sign. Yes, we've ordered those signs, and they'll be, I think, about a 6-week delivery or so.
I'm assuming it's with the new public realm study.
Yes,
guidelines.
those have been designed and council has reviewed those previously.
Okay, previous to me being on council.
Yeah. Yes.
Awesome.
Yes.
And then the other thing is the sidewalk and the asphalt, is that level still within the lane? So it's still going to be kind of a mixed pedestrian parking zone?
Yeah, the curb will only be just a slight swale curb. Yeah. It won't be a barrier for sure. It'll be easily mountable, and you can walk over it, no issues.
Wonderful. Yeah. Thank you so much.
Councillor Albrecht.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you for your report, Rick. Going back to the Salt Lake, Salt Lane sign, we have heard from some businesses in Salt Lane about getting some kind of a directional information that maybe could be incorporated with that sign to help direct, you know, passing traffic from Fraser Highway into the lane. And I don't know if that's reached your desk, but I just thought I would throw that out here right now as something that we have heard, and we should keep in mind or maybe consult with some of those businesses before we do the finished product. Thank you.
Okay. Councillor Arnold.
Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. I was going to tease Councillor Martin about how fast she's coming up 201A. That she has trouble seeing the traffic that's going through, but I decided not to do that.
Councillor Storterboom.
Oh, thank you, Mr. Mayor, and thank you, Mr. Baumhoff, for another excellent report. And yeah, it's spring, and the sun is shining, and the days are longer, and there's more people walking around in the community. Do we take this opportunity to do a review of the pedestrian crossings to be sure that everything is in order? Sometimes it seems like, you know, there's some that don't work for a little while. Do we just respond to calls that we get, or do we act proactively and do a walkabout and check those all ourselves?
Are you saying there's some that don't work? I'm not. In terms of the actual pedestrian controls?
Well, I do a lot of walking, and every now and then I come across one of these, and I'll push it a couple, two, three times, and it won't, you know, activate. So I'm thinking that there's probably a few around town, and it might be worthwhile to do a review, just like when the fall comes and the time changes and it gets dark, we should probably review the streetlights, that sort of thing, right? Yep. I'm just talking about an annual kind of a walkthrough, and I'm not sure if that's part of the maintenance plan or if we just respond to calls that we get, but it might be a worthwhile consideration.
They are checked on a regular basis, but excellent. If you do have specific locations, we can make sure that we go back to those quickly.
Yeah, there's one at the Poseidon on 208 and Fraser Highway that I noticed last week, right behind the, what's the name of that lovely hamburger joint there in the mall?
Original Joe's?
That's right, Original Joe's restaurant there.
So the pedestrian signal was not working properly there?
That's correct. Okay. It didn't work for me going westbound. So, yeah, and I just thought, maybe there's a few others that are around town, but you say that we're checking on them regularly, and I'm good with that. Thank you very much, Mr. Baumhoff, and thank you, Mr. Mayor.
Mr. Baumhoff, the paving here on in front of us, in front of the Tim Center, when will that happen?
That is happening anytime now. We have it in our contract, and it's been awarded. So it's just a matter of scheduling it. Right now we're dealing with, at the intersection, there's a drainage issue right at the laneway as well as the entrance to the mall. So we want to make sure that that's addressed before we do the final lift of paving. And then they can also do the crosswalks and finalize it. Once the crosswalks are done there, then they can actually initiate the signal as well. So it's all kind of hinging on each other. We just met today to talk about that. So we're trying to expedite that as quickly as possible. So I would say within the next 4 to 6 weeks, we would have that done.
Okay. And then on 200th Street, there's a new apartment being built. Are there any other services being cut across, water, sewer, any more cuts there?
On 200th?
Yes. So you're going to get, you know, as I always have a concern when you put in a new pavement, so I'm assuming you're going to be paving that pretty soon, you know, the weather's pretty nice, so there's no more cuts required there, there's no properties changing hands, you contacted development services, there's...
I mean, we coordinate as much as we can with development services, but guaranteed, you know, as soon as you think that it's done and you won't have an issue, there'd be another applicant come in, and, you know, we can't control that.
Well, the one I'm thinking of is the 7-Eleven, right? So... The the area there. They haven't started the building yet, and I was just wondering if there's any cuts required for that. So,
I mean, that I'd have to double check the servicing, but I believe it was being serviced off the back lanes.
Okay.
But I can double check that to ensure that it's okay. Not cut for that reason. Yeah.
Just as a major major star beside your to check.
Yeah.
Thank you. Anything else from Mr. Baumhoff? No? That's it. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Next item we have is recreation update with Ms. Hilton.
Good evening, Your Worship, members of council, and our viewing audience. This is our recreation update for April. As always, we're starting with special events. And this is the public's second opportunity to come out and test out some of the programs and the facility at the new Tim's Community Center. On Saturday, April the 9th, from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m., we have an open house. All programs, drop-in and weight room fitness, are free for the day, the games room as well. We have a number of different programs running, including volleyball, badminton, pickleball. There will be pickleball instruction for people who want to learn how to play pickleball. We have some parent-taught activities. We have some lawn bowling will be present as well. For fitness side of things, we do some Zumba Gold. We're going to do yoga Pilates course. We're offering two spin fit classes, which are really popular and really sweaty when you get out of there. We also have a number of arts and crafts activities for children and some entertainment as well. So it's going to be another great day at the Tim's Community Center for people to come down. And they still have the opportunity to get their 7 free passes, which expire at the end of April. But you can still, if you haven't got one yet, you can come down and give us a try. You'll be hooked after 1 week. So that's the Tim's Community Center open house with the City of Langley on Saturday, April 9th from 10 a.m. to 4 p.m. We are also in partnership with the Langley Early Childhood Development Committee offering a Child Day. And CHILD stands for Children's Health Information Learning and Development. And this is being hosted at Tim's Community Center in the gymnasium on Saturday, April the 16th. We'll have a wide variety of service providers present within the gymnasium offering their services and to make people or parents more aware of what's out there for, you know, birth to 6 years old in particular. And we'll have face painting, story time, and that sort of thing. So again, it's a free event. It's being held at Tim's Community Center on Saturday, April the 16th. And this is always one that council loves to get involved with, is our Operation Clean Sweep. And April 23rd, from 9 a.m. till noon, if you meet our staff down at McBurney Plaza, which is 20518 Fraser Highway, and we're going to have a pitch-in event. And last year we had a lot of green men walking around picking up garbage, and I know the mayor and his wife were out there as well. So we invite you to participate with us by volunteering and help cleaning up our community. You don't need to pre-register anything, and we would love to see you down there on April the 23rd from 9 a.m. till noon. And I believe I mentioned this last update as well, but our early registration has started from March the 2nd to May 8th for our annual Try-It Triathlon. It's being held on Sunday, June the 12th, and we have events for youth, adults, relay teams, and new this year is a Dave Hall Classic for 60-plus years. It's a great deal to register in advance. Not only is your registration less expensive, but you also get a t-shirt included as well. There's more information on our City of Langley website for distances for both the swim, for all three, the swim, bike, and run. If you want a phone, you can phone 604-514-2940 to get more information or head out to our website. It's a busy time coming up. We have our 54th annual Langley Walk. This has been going for 54 years. It's quite amazing. Sunday, May the 1st, it's always the first Sunday of May. And again, we're hosting it in the City of Langley, based out of the Tim's Community Center, to showcase off our beautiful new facility. It is a free family event. Entertainment and registration starts at 12 p.m. The walk starts at 1:30, and it'll take you through all our lovely trails through the Nicomaco floodplain and around our community. For more information, you can phone 604-514-2940 or go onto our website at city.langley.bc.ca. This is a free event, and it's a lot of fun for families and individuals. Youth Week is also the first week in May, and part of the Youth Week events, we are hosting Langley Action for Mental Health. It's to promote Mental Health Awareness Day on Friday, May the 6th from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. in Douglas Park. And we are going to have a huge yoga event. And this is in conjunction with the Langley Division of Family Practice. And it's Child and Youth Mental Health and Substance Youth Local Action Team that's putting this together. It goes from 11 a.m. to 1:30 p.m. And again, there's entertainment, there's food, and there's some poster contests that will be unveiled as well that day. So again, Friday, May the 6th, Douglas Park, from 11 a.m. to 2 p.m. It's a free event again. And come out and show our support to the youth in our community. Our recreation guide you can find in any of our facilities, whether it's City Hall, Langley Library, Douglas Recreation Center, Tim's Community Center, or soon, L. Anderson Pool. This is your guide for recreation opportunities for the spring and summer, so right through to the end of August. It has a lot of different programs, particularly for summer day camps, for those parents who are starting to think about what they're going to be doing this summer with their kids. It's all in this guide or online. We're fortunate to partner with the BCRPA, so the British Columbia Recreation and Parks Association, as well as the Hip Health, Center for Hip Health and Mobility, to offer two programs to seniors 65 and older who are primarily inactive. And we're really trying to get these individuals moving to increase their health. It's a free program, so the funding's being offered through the Hip Health and BCRPA. It's based out of our community center, Tim's Community Center, and the program starts April 18th. If it's something that you're interested in, you want to start getting moving, getting those joints active, phone 604-514-2940. This is the Choose to Move program. It's a six-month supported activity plan, so you get a trainer working with you, a regular support one-on-one consultation, so it's really quite an amazing program. And paired with this, you don't have to do both, you can do one or the other or both, is this active age. And this is a fun, free, and social program that'll get you moving in a relaxed environment. And again, this is a free program as well, and again, targeting seniors 65, or adults, I should say, maybe, 65 and older, who are primarily not being very active. We have two options. We have starting April 12th to June 28th from 9:30 to 10:30 on Tuesdays. This is a functional training program. And option two is a fitness and sports following on Tuesdays 11 to 12, and that runs from April the 12th to June 28th. Again, if you're interested, please phone 604-514-2940. It is a free program, and it will really benefit. We have been getting a lot of feedback on our new community center, and even though when we did our survey of our community members, we didn't get much feedback about child minding, we have received some now, and so we have implemented two additional child minding days, Wednesdays and Fridays, from 9 to 10:30 a.m., and it's $3 per child. So if you're interested, please drop down. You can take part in a spin class or another fitness class or workout in the weight room, and your children will be looked after for you. And our Cookie Monster preschool program, we have started our registrations for the 2016-17 school year. We still have some spaces. We have a three-year-old program Tuesdays and Thursday mornings from 9 to 11:30. We have a 3-4 science and nature focused programs in the afternoons on Tuesdays and Thursdays from 12:30 to 3. And then we have our four-year-old program Monday, Wednesday, Friday. There's either a morning class from 8:30 till 11:30 a.m. or an afternoon class from 12:30 to 3:30 p.m. phenomenal program, great, amazing instructor. For more information, you can phone 604-514-2865, and that's at Douglas Recreation Center in the city of Langley. I just thought I'd share some statistics for you with our Tim's Community Center. So from February 24th to March 31st, we sold a total of 6,127 passes. And I just pulled off some of the top selling passes. As you can imagine, we sold 2,100 adult free visits. Next was our seniors at 996. Then we had our youth at 654. And then our games room, the $10 a year pass for the games room and track, we sold 617 adult passes. So those are just the ones that we've sold or had to register people for. Then I'd like to share our membership usage. So we've had over 12,000 visits in that time period. And of those 12,000 visits, 3,382 of those visits were unique visitors. So that tells me people are coming back, which is great. And just to hit some of the highlights, just over 2,800 adults were using their free visits. Over 2,100 adults were using their games room and track. That track is popular. So is the games room too, though. And surprisingly, over 1,300 seniors were using the games and track, greater usage than their 7 free visits, which is pretty impressive. And our youth, at just over almost 1,300 youth were using their free passes. And finally, just over 1,100 seniors using their free visits. So we are busy downstairs. The facility is being well used. We are tracking when our peak times are and making adjustments with our scheduling and staffing to accommodate those. And we've also just published on the website and posted on the gymnasium door our new gymnasium schedule for through to the end of June. So we have a lot of opportunity for table tennis, pickleball. There's toonie drop-ins Monday, Wednesday, Friday mornings if you get an early start from 6:30 to 8:30. Basketball is very popular. Pickleball is growing, so there's something for everyone. There's just open gym time, so you can pick what you want to do, or you can drop in and do a particular sport. And that is my presentation.
Thank you. Councillor Arnold.
Yeah, all the numbers that you had there, when someone's going to the track, are they supposed to report to the desk first?
They need to swipe in, yes.
Okay. No, because any time I go to the track, I come in, I go to the track. I don't necessarily, so I didn't know if you had a little camera counting us or how.
So how many more swipes should we add to our stats here?
Okay. Any further questions? Seeing none.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presentation. Under the business portion, we have under bylaws now. First, second, and third reading of the bylaw cited as the Highway and Traffic Regulation Bylaw 2013, number 2871, Amendment number 2, Bylaw 2016, number 2984. And this is for the Highway Traffic Regulation. I need a mover and a seconder. Councillor Martin, Councillor Storteboom. Any kind of discussion? Councillor Storteboom.
Thank you very much. My understanding is that this was the plan that was approved by Metro Vancouver. By consent agenda.
Yes, that's correct. Yes.
Thank you very much.
Welcome. Councillor Pahal.
Thanks. This is just for my own information. Was 208th ever in the MRN network?
I don't believe so, no.
Okay,
no.
Thanks.
Further, seeing none, called question. All those in favor? Against? It's unanimous 4. New and unfinished business, we have some correspondence from the Royal Society of St. George, and then we have from the Corporation of Delta a request for funding support for the Volunteer Cancer Driver Society. And as this, yeah, move for receipt, and seconder, Councillor Albrecht. Anything, discussion on those? All those in favor? It's unanimous 4. Under new business, I have one item here. It's pertaining to the Parks Committee. Councillor Arnold has volunteered to step aside to from being a co-chair on parks to allow Mr. Pahal to have a committee. And so I need a motion to rescind Councillor Arnold and to move Councillor Pahal as co-chair. So moved by Councillor Martin, seconded by Councillor Albrecht. Thank you, Councillor Arnold, for letting all those in favor. It's unanimous 4. So you're on a committee now. You got your first.
On the other side this time.
Yeah, don't create waves though now. Come on. Anything else under new business? Councillor Martin?
Yes, thank you. I'd just like to inform Council that under the auspices of the Economic Development Committee, which consists of myself, Councillor Albrecht, and Mr. Minchuk, we're starting our business walks tomorrow and Wednesday. And basically, you know, we can consider a business walk the foundation of building a relationship and networks with businesses in our community over time. And it'll give us the opportunity to understand the issues of the existing business community, let them know what information they can access. So there will be a report probably in the next, maybe the next council meeting as to how the business walks go. But we have 6 interviews scheduled over the next 2 days. So this is, I think, a first, doing the business walks. And we're starting with the industrial area. And we're going to do 2 business walks a year. The next one, I guess, will be the retail sector. So it'll be interesting, and I think it'll be fun, and get to know some of our businesses and our community.
Wow.
So thank you.
Great. Something new, something different. Thank you, councillors. Anything else? I need a motion to adjourn. Councillor Storterboom, Councillor Pahal. All those in favor? It's unanimous 4.
Thank you.